Welcome to Someone Talked, the official podcast of the National D-Day Memorial, where leading experts spill all the secrets of the Second World War with your host, Dr. John C. McManus.
Greetings. Welcome to Someone Talked. I am your host, Dr. John C. McManus, Career Distinguished Professor of U.S. Military History at Missouri S&T. And alongside, as always, are my partners in crime, April Cheek Messier and John Long of the D-Day Memorial. How are you doing?
Happy to be here.
Hello, John. Doing great.
Absolutely. It's great to be here, as always. And we have the amazing Jennet Conant with us here today. Jennet is the author of 6 books. She comes from a journalism background, once wrote for Newsweek, for GQ, Vanity Fair, Esquire, among others. She's just a remarkable storyteller who has an incredible knack for delving deeply into often like the technical and scientific side of World War II and making it intelligible for the rest of us. Like any good writer, she has such a feel for a compelling human story and all the human discourse and foibles and all the rest of it. So her books read like novels, but they're incredibly researched. And Jenny, I just wanted to thank you so much for joining us today.
Oh, it's an honor to be here.
So let's start with, how you got involved in this whole world of writing books about World War II. Your grandfather, of course, was James Conant, who was a very distinguished chemist. He was president of Harvard University, and he was really, I think, really the major player on the Office of Strategic Research and Development of World War II. But of course, you knew him as a human being. Tell us about him. What was he like? What was his background? How does him being your grandfather influence your work today?
Well, he wasn't sort of a normal grandfather, and it wasn't sort of a normal household because, he was a scientist. He was very involved with, as you said, the weapons research for World War II. But above all, Roosevelt appointed him and another scientist, Vannevar Bush, as head of the Manhattan Project. So my grandfather, who really was a civilian scientist, a chemist at Harvard, he became a warrior scientist. He became a weapons maker. And as a chemist, he was in charge, obviously, of chemical weapons, which was poison gases. But what most people don't realize is also a bigger chemical weapon was the bomb. So he oversaw the Los Alamos bomb project, the development of the atomic bomb, and was, on the committee to decide to drop it. Will weigh heavily on a man. And so he became a part of that group of scientists that was responsible for developing the deadliest weapon known to man and the decision to drop it, not once, but twice. And then, of course, the burden of guilt that came with that, not only of the nuclear fallout, the devastating effect on Japan, but the nuclear arms race that developed. And he was a major player in our post-war nuclear policy. So obviously, growing up in that household, it was a legacy, I believe, of heroic wartime service. But there was also a legacy of guilt and a very heavy sense of civic, public, worldwide responsibility. It was a heavy family. Thanksgiving in our house was a heavy scene because I grew up in Cambridge, Massachusetts, part of my life, surrounded by all the wartime scientists. They were a very close-knit group, so they were extended family. So around our table at Thanksgiving and Christmas were Cyril Smith, who built the metal casing for the bomb, George Kiszczakowski, who built the detonator. So obviously conversation drifted from very serious matters of the day. I grew up during the Vietnam War, so they were discussions of the use and development of napalm, a World War II weapon that was coming into vast use during Vietnam, and chemical weapons, Agent Orange, and then nuclear policy was heavy duty. So I grew up, in that environment, to give you an idea. So many of the stories I ended up writing about were stories that I heard discussed, at home, essentially. It was the major topic of conversation. I ultimately ended up writing a biography of my grandfather called Warrior Scientist that came out about 4 years ago. And it was interesting because obviously it was predominantly about the development of the bomb and the Los Alamos project and everything that led up to that. But I did have to write a little bit about chemical weapons. And as you said, it was surprising to me that there was so much to do on chemical weapons in World War II. And among his papers, there was a lot on mustard gas, which was not surprising because as a very young scientist during World War I, he had helped develop and manufacture mustard gas to ship to the Allies. But I did see the record of this, you know, it was sort of an accident in Bari. But what's more surprising to me was in the same folder at the back was the fact that my grandfather in 1945 joined the board of Memorial Sloan Kettering Hospital. So did Vannevar Bush, the other head of the Manhattan Project. So did the names of a number of the men on my grandfather's Harvard chemical weapons, poison gas research division. And I remember thinking at the time when I was looking at this, writing the book, what are all these guys doing on the board of a cancer hospital? I thought it was really odd. And my grandfather was very Yankee. He never went to the doctors. He was a very stoic guy. He was a big mountain climber. In our household, there were no such things as allergies or, you know, minor ailments. If the bone wasn't poking through the skin, you were supposed to like shut up and get on with it. It's a very Yankee attitude that imbued our house. And so I thought that he was the least likely guy to go on the board of a hospital. And so I did a little more reading and I realized that all of these poison gas guys, essentially, poison gas, chemical warfare guys were recruited to go work on turning, you know, beating plowshares, you know, weapons into plowshares, you know, beating these chemical weapons, these deadly gases into medical treatments for cancer, because they had discovered during the Bari disaster that they had a potential for medicine, a potential not to kill, but to cure. So I became intrigued and I started reading a lot about the Bari disaster. And that is how I came onto the story of this young doctor, Lieutenant Colonel Stuart Alexander, and his contribution to medicine.
So Jennet, your book that's based on that, The Great Secret, the Classified World War II Disaster that Launched the War on Cancer, is phenomenal, came out in 2020. As you're uncovering this research, is it because there was just not a lot known about the Bari disaster and how this mustard gas could lead to these cancer treatments? What prompted you to want to write more about this and tell this story more fully?
The Bari disaster was so shrouded in secrecy, and all of the scientific findings were censored, completely classified and covered up, that the story was never properly told. The only book that had been written by a former Air Force captain, Glenn Infield, was great in that it kind of blew the cover off of the secrecy, but there was so little that Infield could lay his hands on, and it was so covered in secrecy that one, he got a lot wrong, and B, I think to sort of make the story complete, he partly fictionalized a bunch of events. So in reading that, I saw immediately the potential basically to tell the story properly for the first time, to get the documents declassified, to unearth the original reports and really tell. It's really a medical scientific detective story. Stuart Alexander, this young army doctor, was sent in to diagnose these dying men and get to the bottom of what happened in this disaster, to report truthfully his findings that, in fact, instead of a German chemical air, you know, weapons strike or just some sort of munitions accident, that in fact the U.S. Merchant vessel, the John Harvey, was carrying 200,000. Mustard bombs that they had been detonated in one of the worst naval accidents, airstrikes of the war, and that this was in essentially a devastating poison gas incident, and that it was covered up. And Lieutenant Colonel Stuart Alexander's report, he wrote a 10-day report the mustard gas casualties at Bari was classified. And so I tracked down that report. It was with great difficulty. Edgewood Arsenal had conveniently, quote unquote, lost it. And so I went to his family, and his family, he had died, but his family had boxed up all of his papers, and he had kept diaries, copies of his reports, memos, telegrams, everything, with the idea that one day a book should be written. And he, in fact, had started dictating his memoirs and died before he completely finished. And so with that, you know, treasure trove of wartime research and papers, a great many of them classified, I went to work on the book.
Jenny, Cornelius Rhodes, Dusty Rhodes, inevitably was his nickname, is obviously a major figure in your story, The Great Secret. And a little bit of a controversial figure in history. So tell us more about Dr. Rhodes.
Well, you know, Dusty Rhodes was, by the time the war broke out, he was head of Memorial Hospital, which was the leading cancer hospital in the United States and in possibly the world. And in those days, all scientists and doctors, for the most part, did their wartime service. So he was serving at that point as head of the medical division of the chemical warfare division. So he was in charge of, you know, again, the chemical weapons research. Mostly in that point, it was defensive, you know, impregnating clothing with chemicals to protect the servicemen from chemical weapons, developing gas masks, better treatments should they be exposed. But also, they were through espionage and capture. They were getting more and more samples of new German poison gases. And in 43, when he took over as head of the medical division of the chemical warfare division, there was a great fear that the Germans, as a last desperate measure, would resort to poison gas. The Germans had been the far and out leaders in poison gas in World War I. And so Churchill absolutely believed that if he was losing the war, Hitler would use poison gas. So so Rose had a very important job, and he was monitoring all poison gases that they were finding in German caches in North Africa and in the Mediterranean. The Germans, as they retreated, dumped a lot of loads of poison gas because it was heavy. They would dump the armaments outside Italian ports. We would go find them and test them. And the Germans were developing a new, more deadly poison gas every 6 months at this point. So there was constant research being done on these new poison gases, both to determine what they were and to develop new treatments against them should they be used. So Rhodes was, as I said, very important. He also, as you mentioned, was very controversial because he was very aggressive, very ambitious scientist, and he had been accused of using humans in testing drugs in Puerto Rico when he was a young doctor, and that had tainted his legacy somewhat. And during World War II, he would again use human subjects as test subjects. We were running huge programs to test poison gases because we felt they were a really, really serious and lethal threat. So servicemen who volunteered or were pressed into service would be exposed to poison gas. We would test how well the equipment worked. This would, after the war, be a subject of enormous controversy because many of these servicemen suffered from overexposure and had lifelong injuries and ailments as a result of being used as human test subjects in chemical warfare experiments. So this is a very controversial and not very much talked about corner of the war.
Yeah. So, you know, on it's what's so fascinating about the book on one level, especially like the first half of it, it's really a very sordid tale that you've delved into of obviously, you know, this screw up in a way of the Germans being able to pull off this raid on Bari and inflict that kind of damage, sinking so many ships and obviously unleashing the mustard gas that victimizes hundreds of sailors. And of course, with these official denials and all this, and poor Colonel Alexander is dealing with all this, even as he's trying to save lives and he's trying to gather data. And then, of course, there's the you know, like you said, the servicemen who are exposed to poison gas and the government denials, all of those really kind of dark aspects of this. And in a way, the second half of the book gives us something more uplifting in the sense that, of course, Alexander has noticed mustard's effect on dampening down white blood cells, and others have too. It's almost like the research has been kind of waiting to take off. And then certainly the Bari disaster and I guess all these others too contribute then to momentum of researching how chemotherapy can come into being. So, you know, like, so how does all that happen? And where does that lead immediately after World War II?
Well, you know, that's the thing about wars is that the one of the benefits of war, as you might put it, is that millions of dollars are put into developing weapons and technology. And afterwards, all of that technology, certainly after World War II, you know, resulted in a huge boon in biomedical science because they had just, the government had poured so much money and the best brains in the world into developing these new tools. And then once they are taken in peacetime and applied to medicine, as you said, there's just this, you just harvest this technology and this wisdom. What happened during World War II was we had secret laboratories, government laboratories at universities all over America doing tests on captured German poison gases. And Lieutenant Colonel Alexander had worked on one at Edgewood Arsenal, and he had seen in rabbits and tests on animals that when they used this poison gas, it absolutely decimated the white blood cell count and the lymphocytes. And he realized then that had an immediate application to blood cancers, particularly leukemia, which is the most common cancer that kills children, because that cancer is characterized by runaway blood cell count. So if you have a chemical that can depress white blood cell counts, then you have an opportunity to possibly chase away those diseased cells to stop that runaway lethal process in the body and save lives. And he immediately mentioned that to his supervisor at Edgewood Arsenal, who said, you know, basically, dude, we're here to develop weapons and protective clothing and gear, and miracles will have to wait for after the war. So he was not allowed to pursue it. But Dusty Rhodes, who was head of the medical division, had noticed the same thing, and he was getting Alexander's reports from Edgewood Arsenal. And those same captured German gases were then sent to Yale, where they had a secret laboratory. And the doctors there did parallel research that Alexander had done. And they did indeed see that mustard gas could deplete white blood cell counts. So they started doing trials on very, very sick human beings that were beyond cure, that had tried and exhausted everything known to medicine at that point. And they started using what they thought and what they hoped were tiny, tiny titrated samples of mustard gas, injecting them into these patients. A great number of them died, but one or two showed remarkable resurgence in their health, and the tumors shrunk, and the white blood cell count was repressed. And so they knew they were on to something. And that all happened, you know, prior to the war. So the moment the war ended, Dusty Rhodes took his findings and he took the Bari report written by Stuart Alexander and all of the 400 sort of autopsy cases that he had accumulated from Bari showing the depleted white blood cell count. And he presented them, it was a famous lecture on the Bari disaster and the white blood cell count. And he determined that from that evidence and the evidence accumulated in government labs and government funded studies on humans, that they were looking at a possible treatment for cancer. And so a huge amount of money, government money, starting from 1945, literally the day the war ended, Memorial Sloan Kettering was announced. And they started pouring millions of dollars of research into turning mustard gas into what is now called chemotherapy. And the first cure that was developed was for childhood leukemia. And they started saving children that were between the ages of 3 and 7 for whom that disease had been absolutely fatal until that time.
So Jennet, just to follow up on that, would you say that, is it fair to say that today's chemotherapy techniques are still a direct descendant of the mustard gas discoveries? Or do you think there have been so many advances that the link is too distant? How do you view that?
Oh, no, they're still an absolute descendant. I mean, what really has happened is most people are familiar with the phrase, a cocktail of drugs. Chemotherapy, not surprisingly, mustard gas is, it's a poison. So it has terrible side effects. So everything that's been done since World War II has been to counter the side effects and to make the drug more palatable to the human system, make it more tolerable to the human system. So other drugs have been developed side by side and introduced along with it. You have a lot of very new cancer drugs that have been developed now that are not derived from mustard gas. But interestingly, I think by and large, the majority of the most successful treatments are still a cocktail, using some chemotherapy and some of the new biologic drugs. Chemotherapy from mustard gas is still very much one of the dominant treatments in cancer today. It is more successful against some cancers than others. It is less successful against tumors, obviously far more successful against blood cancers.
So Rhodes is intriguing too as a kind of a character. He's part doctor, he's part marketing and PR guy.
Huge fundraiser.
He's a big fundraiser. He's like a national spokesperson, for this whole approach to the treatment of cancer. And obviously
we all know the phrase war on cancer. That came from that huge funding drive. Yeah.
And that's the phrase he adopts, right? I mean, that's so in terms of his background, this is something that I wondered about your opinion. He had the stint in Puerto Rico, and so one night he writes this bizarre letter. Like, he gets drunk and writes this bizarre letter ripping the Puerto Ricans, claiming that he injected them with cancer. I don't know if that's even possible, but I guess maybe it is. I don't know. Do you think that was a joke like he claimed, or what's your take on that?
It's very hard to know. He was a doctor doing testing. They were trying to develop various new drugs in Puerto Rico. It's working for the Rockefeller Institute. In those days, that was done, I think that was done in the 30s. Turn of the century, right through like the 1930s, a human testing was very much what was done. And unfortunately, it tended to be done in third world countries. So we would send some posse of doctors from the Rockefeller Institute, heavily endowed, to work on smallpox vaccines or whatever. And they would go to Africa. They would go to one of the islands. They would go to Puerto Rico. That's not a good look today. We don't approve of that, but that's just what medicine did in those days. Puerto Rico was becoming increasingly political, agitating for independence. They were not in love with having rich New York doctors doing medical studies. So it had already become politically a little bit polarized, his mission in Puerto Rico, as a time of political foment. And, you are taking peasants very poor people off the land. You can hardly sign their name, and asking them to sign consent, medical consent forms. Not even clear what kind of consent was extracted. And while these experiments were not deadly and no cancer was ever injected into anybody, there were all kinds of rumors. And he says he got drunk and he wrote this letter. And it's a bad letter. There's no way to look at this letter except to say that it's a bad letter. And I think at one point he's mad. He's mad about the poor facilities, and he's mad about, you know, all the problems he's having doing this study. So he badmouths the Puerto Ricans, but he calls them a sort of a corrupt, filthy race and a lot of other, you know, horrific terminology and frankly, racist terminology. And a lab assistant takes this. It gets in the hands of the political opposition, the independence movement. They Xerox it. They publicize it. It's on the front page of the papers in Puerto Rico. It becomes a huge story in the New York tabloids. It was a big controversy. It speaks to the money and the power of the Rockefeller Institute that they managed to dampen the whole thing down. And obviously, Cornelius Dusty Rhodes was recalled. But his career recovered and then flourished. And I would say probably because it was a fairly racist time. And human testing in medicine was very much in vogue. So he was not held personally responsible for what seemed like a politically polarizing moment in Puerto Rico. I would add, however, that the Puerto Rican government has pursued and pursued and pursued its cause against Rhodes. They fully believe, a group of people fully believe, that he did inject cancer and kill a handful, a half dozen Puerto Rican citizens. And they have tried to pursue justice. There have been books written about this incident in Puerto Rico. And in the end, pursuing justice, they had Cornelius all of the honors and scholarships and everything at Memorial Sloan Kettering stripped. His name has pretty much been erased from the history of Memorial Sloan Kettering, even though he was its founding doctor and really firebrand and fundraiser and everything because of this cloudy, murky incident in his past.
So I have to ask this question. And so just to diverge a little bit from a moment from the great secret to talk about another one of your books, because I'm a huge fan of Julia Child and just love her story, love her. And, you know, here she was during the war. We don't often, people wouldn't necessarily associate her with wartime heroics in World War II. But, you know, she joins the OSS because she's too tall for the military. She ends up, you know, doing some pretty remarkable things. Can you tell us a little bit about Julia Child's wartime service, your book about her and Paul, and just share a little bit about that with our listeners?
Well, I've written two books about the atom bomb. So I was trying to do something a little more cheerful. It was announced, I think I was on my book tour, you know, talking about the atom bomb every day is a little depressing. And it was announced that Julia Childs had been a member of the OSS. And I just immediately thought, well, how fun is that? That would be a fun story. So I did that book. And, you know, she kept a lot of letters and she met this man that she fell in love with in the OSS when she was abroad, named Paul Child. And he was a very interesting guy. And he was a real gourmet and traveled the world and loved to eat foreign food. And she was just this big, strapping ranch girl from California. She could not cook, she couldn't boil water. Her idea of American food was steak and potato dinner. You know, that was it. And she was, you know, people don't realize she was like 40. You know, it wasn't like she was some young thing. He's just what they were. When they were in India and China, you know, he kept insisting on going out to like local restaurants, and they'd get deathly ill because we didn't have the stomachs for the local cuisine. And so they'd go out and, you know, eat the local specialties, and then they'd have dysentery for 10 days. And then he'd say, let's do it again. And, but, you know, he was passionate about this, and she fell madly in love with him. And so in between kind of their missions for the OSS, in which she was doing strange things like cutting opium, which was a payment they used for their local spies, they would go out and you know, test the local cuisine. And she learned a lot about food. And, you know, when the war ended, she wanted to marry this guy. And she wanted to win him over. And he thought she was pretty plebeian in her palate and her tastes in food. So she's trying to learn how to cook. So she started taking cooking lessons when she got back to California. And her letters of like learning how to make pancakes, pretty hair raising. You'd never believe that the person who wrote that letter would go on to become a world-class chef. So anyway, it was quite a lot of fun. And it got me a chance to write about the OSS, which was a pretty hilarious outfit in many regards. I mean, they just had the most eccentric group of people in the world recruited there. And Julia Child, who was really this fascinating and very bright woman, really, you know, she kind of found her people there. It was great fun to write about the OSS and the kinds of eccentric eggheads that they recruited and then put to work doing very odd things. So.
And she used to say, I think her first recipe was actually developing the shark repellent with the OSS.
Oh, yeah.
I love that.
That was a really great OSS program. She was part of a group that was trying to develop a wetsuit for divers that would repel sharks. Let's just say that particular group never did get off the ground, but they worked at it for a while.
Jennet, someone else has an interesting wartime history, and most people wouldn't realize it, and that is Roald Dahl, the children's author. Tell us about him and your book, The Irregulars.
Well, I got into spies for a while. Spies are really fun to write about, but this was the most fun book I've ever done. Basically, I was looking to do a book on spies, partly because I had finished these two books on the bomb. And the thing about the atom bomb that, you know, is so alarming and so sad in a way is that the man that developed the atom bomb, Robert Oppenheimer, who my grandfather adored, he was a very close family friend. And he was the man more responsible than any single individual for getting the atomic bomb project off the ground and developing this weapon in 27 months that ended the war. Irregardless of whether you are a fan of the atom bomb or not, he did what his country asked him to do. It was a Herculean task. And they built this weapon that most people thought was something out of science fiction. And they completed it in 27 months under enormous pressure and used it to end the Pacific War. And I believe saved the lives of hundreds of thousands of servicemen who are then on boats leaving Italy, Anzio, and Europe and headed for what they thought was going to be the invasion of the Japanese mainland. So that said, Oppenheimer was accused of being a spy and stripped of his security clearance and really shamed and driven from the scientific community by accusations of espionage. All of that happened without people realizing that all during the Los Alamos project, there were spies right there in Santa Fe and at the project itself, taking notes and passing them to the Russians so that the Russians really had the blueprint for the atom bomb from scientists that were involved at the highest level of the Los Alamos bomb project. And Oppenheimer was never going to jump on a Russian sub. And that was just post-war hysteria and lies. So I became very interested in basically this huge weakness, as it were, in our own intelligence system, that we got it so wrong about Oppenheimer and that we missed all these spies in our midst during the Los Alamos bomb project. Anyway, I was exploring this and fundamentally what people don't realize now is there was no CIA during World War II. We only had the FBI. And the FBI, You know, a lot of them were recruited from the Midwestern states. None of them had been abroad. They didn't speak foreign languages. And as we started bringing in all of these, you know, foreign nationals, they basically thought all of the European scientists were spies. They had heavy accents and they wore strange clothes. And, you know, we were just not very well equipped as a country. We didn't have any foreign intelligence service. And as the war went on, the British noticed, you know, this huge weakness in that we did not have a good foreign intelligence service. And we had Nazis moving into South America. We had the America Firsters campaigning heavily against intervention in England. And the British were like, these Americans need some guidance. So they started sending in a lot of spies into America. Their first goal was to try and pressure, lead, cajole, blackmail maybe, Americans into passing the Lend-Lease Bill. The British were on their last legs. They were not going to survive the next onslaught of the German invasion without help. And they desperately needed weapons, machines, and materiel from America. And Lend-Lease Bill would allow that. And it was stuck in a bitter congressional debate, and it didn't look like it was going to pass. So they sent in what they called Churchill's Dirty Trick Squad, the British Security Coordination. They were called the Baker Street Irregulars by slang, which was the name that was used to describe an informal group of dirty tricksters that had once aided Sherlock Holmes. And that these guys were, a lot of them were either too old for service or they were wounded out of service, like Roald Dahl, who went on to great fame as a children's short story writer, Chitty Chitty Bang Bang, and James and the Giant Peach and whatnot. But at that point, he was just a very, very tall, very handsome, wounded RAF officer who could no longer fly. And so he was sent to the United States to do propaganda work, essentially, to help raise the alarm that England would fall without American help and that we needed America to enter the war on the side of the British. So he was in Washington during that. He got recruited by a famous spy master named William Stevenson, who was brought to fame by a book called A Man Called Intrepid. Intrepid was his code name. And there was a branch of British intelligence in America that used these guys to not only do propaganda, but they really did their worst to help England. They blackmailed senators, if they could, to get them to vote for Lend-Lease. They worked against the American Firsters. And they did everything they could to bring America into the war and raise money and support for the British cause. And Roald Dahl, you know, he was a very mischievous young man. He's very tall, very handsome. One of his jobs was to sleep with Claire Booth Luce, who was on the armaments committee, you know, and get intelligence from her. So, you know, a variety of missions involved here. But anyway, it's great fun, that book. And it's really illuminating because one of the things they did was meddle in our election and have Wallace removed as the vice presidential running mate for Roosevelt the last time because the British did not like Henry Wallace. They thought he was a communist and he was anti-imperial. And they really released a lot of negative information about him, negative intelligence about him. And had him removed from the ticket. So it's a talk about, you know, intellectual, you know, election meddling has been a big topic in our country the last two cycles. And it wasn't the first time. Our elections have been meddled with before. So it's kind of interesting from that perspective, too.
Yeah. And you think about dirty tricks for maybe a better purpose, because when you really stop and think about Henry Wallace becoming president in 1945, that is, I don't know about what you think. I find that a very disquieting scenario.
Very disquieting. I mean, the British were in a blind panic about it because Wallace, you know, he had been vice president already. He was on the nuclear, head of the nuclear committee. The British intelligence told them that Roosevelt would not live, you know, to the end of the next term. He was a dying man, effectively, even though that had been kept from the American public. The British knew that was the case. So they knew that whoever was his running mate would become president. And it was a terrifying prospect to them. And so they really did help remove him from the ticket, which is, I agree with you. We got a much better man in Truman.
Absolutely.
I think history is grateful because Truman would be tested. It's still quite startling when you read in the book the dirty tricks that they pulled to embarrass and blacken Wallace's name. You know, they got these letters. He had fallen under the thrall of some Russian Svengali. He was very interested in mysticism. He was a creepy guy, Wallace. But anyway, he had all these letters, admiring letters to this guy that would have destroyed him. And they got a hold of those and they leaked those. And, you know, they really did cut the ground out from beneath him. And this guy that had really been quite popular and quite critical in carrying the Midwest and getting Roosevelt reelected, they got him removed from the ticket.
Yeah, and Wallace's visit to China didn't do him any good. And of course, then when he did run 1948, he actually did have communists working in his campaign. Was like, so look, what's the problem? You know, it was 1948 America. So, obviously you're always busy doing more work, sleuthing more stories. I know you've been, you know, working a little bit about on Marguerite Higgins. Is there anything you can tell us about your future work and book in the pipeline about that?
Well, Maggie Higgins is a fascinating figure because she's the first woman to win a Pulitzer Prize for combat reporting. And in fact, another woman wouldn't win a Pulitzer Prize for war reporting for 30 years. That gives you an idea of how ahead of her time she was. But she was incredibly controversial. I mean, I think I can safely say there is no more controversial war correspondent in history than Maggie Higgins. And she started out being controversial with her first really big story, which was when she raced ahead of the Third Army into Dachau with a young Stars and Stripes reporter named Peter First. And, was one of the first into the prison yard and announced to the prisoners that they were free. This is a very, very controversial moment in history. It made her world famous, put her on the front page of the New York Herald Tribune and the Stars and Stripes, and brought her a lot of awards and overnight stardom. But as John McManus has written in his wonderful book about the liberation of the prison camps, it's a very murky moment in history. And everybody would point fingers at everybody else and claim that they were first and that she was lying. But, you know, she would go on from that day forward to have a kind of a grandstanding reputation because she was very young. She's 24 when it happened. She was still pretty much a wet behind the ears correspondent. She'd only been in the field in World War II for a couple of months. And she did make herself front and center of that story. And a lot of very weary war correspondents who had been in the trenches for 4 years and had not been eating well and who were exhausted and had been covering battle to battle were pretty bitter that this gorgeous blue-eyed blonde waltzed into the war and in the closing months became world famous. And that would just never change. She would remain controversial and widely resented, both for her scoops and for her looks. And it's sort of a fascinating chronicle. She would get one headline after another in the closing months of World War II. She would cover the Berlin airlift, again, being in the right place at the right time. And she would, it would be rumored, I think, as the famous World War II photojournalist Carl Meidens put it, at one point, the rumor was that she had slept with everybody in the U.S. Army. So the stories about her abounded, of batting her eyes and getting, rides with generals to the front, of batting her eyes and getting, you know, information on secret troop movements so she would be at the right place at the right time and scoop the boys. The stories were very sexist, but it was a sexist moment. She, however, didn't care a fig for feminism And she really didn't care a fig for sexism. She did pretty much as she damn well pleased. And she kept going to the front. She got herself, she was the first in to Seoul during the Korean War with the first group of five journalists. She was there when Seoul fell. The troops were separated from their the reporters were separated from the troop divisions by the river. She got washed ashore. She jumped on a PT boat. She ended up walking 14 miles through occupied territory back to Seoul with her story and filed. She then went on the Patton's invasion of Incheon with the Marines. She went over the seawall with the fifth wave of Marines at Incheon. In fact, she snapped the most iconic photograph at Incheon of a U.S. Marine dying right before he threw himself on a grenade to save his troops. It was only recently recognized by the Marines that she is the one that took that photograph. She was right behind him. She was very brave. She was regarded as brave to the point of reckless by many of her competitors because she kept going to the front, and it meant it was hard for them to stay back at the bureau because their papers kept saying, why the is Maggie at the battle lines and you are back in the bureau? But she won the Pulitzer Prize for combat reporting in Seoul. So she's a fascinating character. And because she was often just the only woman there, her tangle with the U.S. Army is pretty interesting. And she's really single-handedly responsible for having a lot of the rules rewritten for women at the front, women on Navy ships, because she smuggled herself on one to get to Incheon. So it's pretty fun to watch her tangle with MacArthur, major admirals, and get her way with the Army and the Navy. So she was a master at publicity and headline grabbing. And so it's fascinating. And then she ended up dying while covering Vietnam at age 45. So it's a pretty interesting book.
Fascinating stuff. We can't wait for the book. Congratulations in advance on it. Thank you so much for joining us today, Jenny. It's been an honor to have you and to discuss your work. Thank you so much.
Well, I love your program. It's great to be here.
Great to have you. Thanks. John Long, please tell us about our veteran.
Today on our We Salute You feature, we honor the World War II service of Ernest Fulcher, U.S. Navy. Ernest Fulcher was born into dire poverty in the mountains of West Virginia. His mother died when he was young, and his father remarried a woman with several children of her own. So Ernest was forced to live with relatives and friends, seldom with a stable address or enough to eat. By the time he was 14, he determined to join the U.S. Navy, with his father's blessing, largely because they would feed him three meals a day. The recruiter took one look at this scrawny kid and told him to come back later. A year later, he returned, but was told he was still underweight, just under the minimum. With the few cents he had in his pocket, he left and bought bananas and ate them, peel and all, to gain weight. When he returned to the recruiter, he was still under the minimum weight, but the recruiter told him it was close enough and signed him into Uncle Sam's Navy. He was 15 years old and weighed barely 100 pounds. Ernest was posted to PC 624, a patrol craft, one of the underappreciated vessels of World War II. Patrol craft acted as minesweepers and wayfinders for amphibious assaults, directing incoming landing craft to their landing zones. They also served as anti-aircraft and anti-submarine vessels. Interestingly, Ernest was the enlisted man's cook for PC 624, guaranteeing that he would eat well. But on a small vessel like a patrol boat, every man served multiple roles, and at battle stations, Ernest was tasked with dropping depth charges. On July 30th, 1943, PC 624 was credited with sinking a German U-boat, perhaps due to Ernest's depth charge attack. In quieter hours, Ernest, talented with a guitar and a mandolin, formed a hillbilly music group aboard the ship, filling the hole with music. PC 624 served off of North Africa and Italy, playing a part that was unheralded but important. Then, on June 6, 1944, Ernest Fulcher and his patrol craft were off the coast of a stretch of sand codenamed Omaha Beach. From their small craft, the crew could hear the guns and see some of the chaos on the shore. Ernest would never forget the experience of guiding the Higgins boats into the slaughter. "But I was too young to be scared," Mr. Fulcher recently told an interviewer. After the war, Ernest returned home and floated between jobs and locations. He married and became a father, but like many World War II veterans, he had difficulty adjusting to civilian life. For him, religion became an escape from the past, and he took up a higher calling, serving many years as a preacher. Today, Mr. Fulcher is retired in Reiner, Virginia, and is often celebrated at events and in parades as the number of World War II veterans dwindle. He attended the 75th anniversary of D-Day with us at the National D-Day Memorial, and this past Veterans Day also made an appearance, one of only two World War II vets who could be with us. Needless to say, he was treated like a rock star, with people clamoring to shake his hand and take a photo with one of the last representatives of the greatest generation. A large contingent of high school and college ROTC cadets were especially keen to meet him, and it was great to see this hero of the past interact with the heroes of the future. Ernest Fulcher, thank you for your service, and thank you for doing your part to save the world.
It was so great having him with us on Veterans Day. Oh, my goodness. He was a rock star. He had a long line of people waiting to shake his hand.
I mean, he's one of the less than 200,000 who are left.
That's right.
He's also kind of an example of the mobility you see inherent in the war. I mean, there's a guy who may not have ever left his hometown. And then, here he is traveling across the globe and obviously being part of the Normandy invasion. Mm-hmm. Amazing. Yeah, well, this has been, as always, just been an absolutely fascinating episode to explore Jennet Conant's remarkable work. Obviously, her book, The Great Secret, the classified World War II disaster that launched the war on cancer, but also the rest of her backlist and also her future work on Maggie Higgins. Jenny, again, I just wanted to thank you again for coming on today and just fascinating us on so many levels. Thank you.
No, thank you, John. And thank you for all your work.
Well, it's lucky to get to do this.
I agree.
I think we both agree. Yeah, absolutely. Well, you can email our team at podcast@dday.org. Please do so. We love hearing from you. If you're enjoying our discussions on World War II and its lasting impact, please subscribe to the podcast, share it with your friends, rate it, leave us a review. Help us share the lessons and legacies of D-Day and World War II. Thanks for joining us, everybody. Take care.
Someone Talked is a production of the National D-Day Memorial Foundation in partnership with Watts Creative Studios. Views expressed are not necessarily those of the foundation. This program was supported by a grant from Virginia Humanities. Virginia Humanities connects people and ideas to explore the human experience and inspire cultural engagement. As the State Humanities Council, Virginia Humanities reaches millions in its estimated annual audience through festivals, grants, fellowships, digital initiatives, teacher institutes, radio programs, podcasts, apprenticeships, and school programs. Headquartered at the University of Virginia in Charlottesville, Virginia Humanities works to serve Virginians in every corner of the Commonwealth. To learn more, visit virginiahumanities.org. Located in Bedford, Virginia, the community that suffered the highest known D-Day loss per capita in the United States, Congress warranted the establishment of the nation's monument to D-Day in this emblematic American homefront. Receiving no federal or state funding, the memorial is operated and maintained by a private foundation and donor support. Explore the National D-Day Memorial, plan your visit, and learn more about upcoming events at dday.org. Join the conversation. Email our team at podcast@dday.org.
It's no military secret that I love you.
Hey, how about romancing?
If you can keep a secret,
well, can I take you dancing?
If you'll take my heart and keep it, I'm not saying a word. I'm careful whatever I do.
guess everyone's heard. I want to give all my love to you.
If you gotta talk to someone, don't give any information.